You know, Brian, yesterday at the introduction to reform school, I felt like I was a little too self-congratulatory. Like I thought I was all so kind of funny. Like, it's really warm today, but it's going to be cold later in the week. But I'm not a meteorologist. Look how funny I am. Like
classic
I was so,
Bob.
Yeah, like I was so self-congratulatory. So I decided today I would try to not do that.
So is there going
to
be some self-deprecation involved?
Balance would call for that, I think. But alas, I hardly need to introduce the now already seen Brian Carr. Sitting to my right, who is there with, I think, a better framed one shot today. I know the folks at home are watching evolution of our shot framing. And of course, Heather Kays seated in the corner with
Hello.
A bat today in the corner. That's a new installment for the Reform School program. That being a bat made of plastic, I presume, right?
Is
that
right? Yeah, it's a wiffle ball bat.
All right. All right, we'll get to that later in the show as we tease the important things in the show so that people will hang on through the program, like whether it's a wiffle ball bat. Most importantly, though, is the great Dave Trabert joining us from the Kansas Policy Institute. And Dave, thanks for your time on today's Reform School program. We appreciate it.
Happy to be here.
All right. So let's talk about some of the news. And, you know, we have on the Choice Media homepage here, the Teach for America Rethinking Its Training Program. This, of course, a big national story. And you can see here, Chris, if you cut to the website, we will be, there we are, Teach for America Rethinking Its Training Program. There's a James Schulz on yesterday's Reform School showing his smiling face. But I wanted to, before we move further in the regular program, talk about something that Dave knows a lot about, which is this Kansas Supreme Court decision. We referred to it yesterday with James. Here's what the story was. This is the AP version of it carried on Yahoo, but it says the Kansas Supreme Court determined school funding was unconstitutional. And I've got to tell you, Dave, I misinterpreted this story because when I first read it, this is the line in the AP story. Kansas must spend more money on its public schools, the state Supreme Court ruled Friday. That's pretty much all I need to read, Dave, and I say, oh, great. The courts are intervening in a act of judicial activism. This isn't that very good grammar. And I thought, oh, this is a terrible thing, and they're just, it's, you know, kind of a statist thing, saying throw more money at the problem, says Supreme Court. You're here to tell us, Dave, that that's kind of a misinterpretation, right?
That's absolutely a misinterpretation. The statist opinion is coming from media. That is certainly how a lot of media is choosing to interpret that. But the court very clearly did not say that the state needs to spend more money on schools. The only piece that they referenced in regard to funding had to deal with equity. There were two equity issues, one having to do with a local property tax add-on to the foundational formula, and the other being with capital outlay. But in both cases, the court didn't issue an invoice, as has happened in previous court decisions. What they did was say, fix the inequity. One way of doing it would be to spend more money, but that's just one way of doing it.
Right. So this lead, as they say in journalism, couldn't have been more wrong. It basically is saying, quite frankly, the court ordered higher spending. You're telling us that's just not what happened.
That's not what happened.
See, this is why the reform school program is important to our education reformers around the country. Right, Brian? Like, we get the truth from people like Dave. So what they said was, and we can't, you know, I don't want to become like a legal analysis show, but simply what you're saying is, while 9 years ago, we learned yesterday from James, the Kansas Supreme Court had ordered a dollar amount be spent, they didn't do that this time. They sent it to a lower court and just said, you need to address issues of equity.
Well, they told the legislature that they need to address two issues of equity. And they provided, as I said, there's one way they could do it would be by spending some more money. But there are other ways of equitably dividing the funding that's in the system. They gave the legislature until July 1st of this year to make that, to resolve it. And they said if they did, especially if they did choose to do it by putting more money in, then equity is done. It does not go back to the lower court.
All right. Well, let's move around the world and have you hang in, Dave, the world of education reform today on the Choice Media Newswire. And you can feel free to comment as you like. Brian, I understand you followed a story today in Philadelphia involving...
Yeah, this story is kind of sad. It's there's an elementary school, a group of elementary school kids who got suspended for gang activity. It doesn't make sense.
Elementary school kids suspended, and they have actually in the piece here, this is, I guess, myfoxphilly.com, but they actually show, like, I'm just to zoom in on, well, I guess you can't see it. It says, according to the reason given for them being suspended, it says investigation or participation in gang assaults.
Yes.
Kids of
16 students got together and formed a group, and they assaulted kids within that group.
Third through fifth graders.
Third through fifth grade. Yeah, mm-hmm. That sounds like a really horrible recess.
So this would be 8-year-old kids involved, the third graders.
More or less.
So that is hard to imagine. All right, Teach for America.
Teach for America is having problems with teacher preparation, so they're modifying their training. The program, recent members of the program, they have not felt that they were prepared for the classrooms they were going to. So they want to go all the way as far as how they train people. They want to start in junior year of college to train these people. So okay. If you want to be a Teach for America, I mean, normally if you go to school for teaching, you have an inkling of what you want to do come sophomore year of college. But they give you preparatory classes junior year if you pass the application process.
Mm-hmm. And Teach for America, critiqued by opponents of it or you know, detractors by saying, oh, they take these students who know nothing about education because they didn't spend 4 years in education school. They might have been learning chemistry or world history or other kinds of majors. And so it's, you know, 5-week training is not nearly enough.
No.
And so now it's almost as if TFA is...
They're kind of backtracking on, their model, per se. And, they need... apparently, I think the foundation just isn't strong enough, so they want to strengthen the foundation earlier on. I don't know why that is. There's been, changes in leadership over the years in Teach for America, but maybe it's just that the original leadership that founded the place had a stronger idea of how to really get these college students into these classrooms, fresh out of college students, I should say, into these classrooms to really better understand these students and be better prepared for it.
Well, I'm a huge fan of TFA, and I've wondered often, though, why Wendy Kopp is not more... a vociferous defender of her program when it gets criticized by unionistas, if you will. Mm-hmm. I always want her to come back strongly with strongly worded rejoinders, and she tends to be more carefully worded, I think would be fair to say. Dave, your thoughts on TFA? You got some TFA teachers in Kansas?
You know, we probably do. I'm not sure how many, but, the issue of teacher preparation is not one that is unique to TFA. In fact, if you would go look at the National Council on Teacher Quality, you'll find extensive reporting on how the education colleges in the United States don't do a very good job of preparing teachers in the public schools to be effective teachers.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And now we move to Chicago, where it seems every other day, Brian's either Chicago or New York. Have we had a day where you're not in either one of those cities?
I'll be in Jersey soon, Bob.
Yeah, I know. It's what he likes. So this is the ongoing story we've been covering about how some of the teachers there don't want to give the state test, even though by law they're required.
Right. There's a teacher boycott, and now the parents are stepping in to voice their opinion, pick their side.
Chicago parents rally for compassion. A group of over 100 parents and educators rallied in Chicago at Chicago Public School Network No. 7 in support of the teachers who boycotted the Illinois Standards Achievement Test earlier this month. The protesters, who are organized by the Chicago Teachers Union, asked that the Board of Education not retaliate against the teachers who did not administer the test. The plea for mercy comes after the Chicago Public Schools threatened to decertify any teacher who doesn't administer the test. Zerlana Smith, proud parent and Action Now member, thinks, "There will be no retaliation. It's an empty threat." The debate over the ISAT is that it's a dead test and that teachers should be teaching and not training children to take a test that will be gone in a year. Those at the rally had this to say.
This is one test that we're using because it's dead. It's a corpse of a test right now. We're using it as a platform to discuss the larger issues. We want authentic assessment. We assess all the time, and that's called teaching.
Gregory Michie is a public school teacher and senior research associate. He works at the Center for Policy Studies and Social Justice at Concordia University. "I'm not giving the ISAT because it symbolizes the test-driven culture that has distorted teaching and learning, especially for poor students of color." The Chicago Public Schools state that the district is required by law to administer the ISAT and that results from the test help to secure funding to classroom resources. The teachers union continues to dispute that statement.
You know, I'm wondering if there is a, you know, kind of a mock teacher caricature we could do. Maybe someone in a wig, although it looks like Brian's already wearing a wig, but someone in a wig who'd
be like...
Do we
need more hair on the show? Is that what you're saying?
You know, like, it's someone in a wig saying, like, it would be like the secret truth of what the union really thinks, which would be like, we don't want accountability, and if there's testing, then the effectiveness of our teachers will be provable. And so, like, I would like sound bites from the sort of caricature truth serum teacher who's like actually saying what they want. Like,
I mean, maybe there could be subliminal subtitles underneath a YouTube confession or something about teacher quality,
or we can
link
do it
to evaluation, link to salary.
So I don't know, Dave, what your thoughts are on this, but yeah, the teachers in Chicago and many places, and look, I'm not here to say that the teach, you know, how much testing is the right amount, and maybe different kids require different amounts of testing, and there could be, you know, fair-minded people might disagree on that question. But that said, to kind of say, no, we shouldn't give this state test at all because, you know, we just don't like the idea of this measurement unless we're doing it and we make up the grades. I don't know. To me, it sounds like self-protection. What do you think?
You know, it'd be interesting to see if what would happen, what the union's reaction would be if a different group of teachers refused to give a Common Core test for different reasons.
They'd support that, too.
And what the reaction would be. Look, this comes down to teachers having, this is part of their job. They may not like it. They're entitled to their opinion about the efficacy of the test. But they cannot just not do their job because they don't want to. This is a basic employment situation, and they should have to give the test, like it or not.
Yes. Well, as Brian pointed out here in the Chicago Sun-Times, they covered the story with the headline, Protesters say don't punish teachers who didn't administer the ISAT. So I guess we'll have to say this is 100 people rallied to say, don't make these teachers give tests. So anyway, so we'll have to see. I guess that'll be a rolling story, and pretty much every day Brian will either be on this or the De Blasio strip. Pardon? No,
I wonder if the students would get a pass.
Exactly.
If they refused to take the test.
Exactly. I wrote a piece about that was carried in the Daily Caller a couple of years ago and referenced in the Wall Street Journal. It was a satirical piece. Did you know about this, Brian?
No, I did not.
Satirical piece, and it was called. The piece was classroom testing is a war on students. And the whole piece was written as in the exact terminology and logic that the teachers are using why they shouldn't be evaluated generally.
Wow.
Except it said, it was all written except with the word teacher, it would be the word student.
Right, yeah.
So therefore students shouldn't be tested. It's not fair. Students don't have the exact same home life situation. So until there's complete fairness, we can't have these experiments with student testing. So anyway. Just wanted to plug my mic. Heather, save us before we spiral into irrelevance.
I'll do my best.
Yeah, I know. She's going to get out the baseball bat and come after you. So let's see. What's this Common Core textbook story? What do you got going on?
The University of Southern California conducted a study that found that there are books being used in Florida that have labels on the front of them saying that they're in line with Common Core standards, but apparently they're not actually effective textbooks. There was one math book that had only 38% of the material was aligned with Common Core standards, and 16% of what would need it to be known in math for the fourth grade level wasn't included in the book at all.
Right. Yeah, and I see that part right here.
Previously, there was only 45% based on the old standards in Florida, so it's not like it was that drastic of a change, but basically people are looking and saying there's pretty pictures, you know, and an Oprah book club label on the front, so I'm going to buy this textbook, when obviously this is a little bit more important than picking something to read on the weekends.
It gets to a point, and I'm a Common Core skeptic, Dave, but it gets to a point that is Common Core opponents have oftentimes, I think, reacted unfairly by saying any book that's got aligned with Common Core slapped on the front is therefore approved by some sort of secret Common Core, you know, group or whatever, secret meeting of Common Core intellectuals or something. And so, you know, you or me or Heather or Brian, we could all just write some crazy textbook and put a bizarre interpretation of history in it, place aligned with Common Core standards on the front of the textbook, and then people would freak out and say, oh, look what Common Core is telling our kids. Well, it's actually just anybody can put anything they want in a textbook and claim that it's aligned with Common Core. So that's, I guess, what this study's finding.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing secret about this, for goodness sakes. It's very out in the open. There's a very broad attempt to nationalize education. It's nothing secret about it.
Right.
But yeah, sometimes there are overreactions to it.
Yeah.
But, you know, in these days, and especially when you have so many schools providing laptops or iPads to kids, it begs the question, how much longer are we going to continue to subsidize the textbook industry? The problems with trying to update are very much simplified if you just do it electronically.
Mm-hmm. The next story, Heather, I'm delighted that you'll be reading the story instead of me. Go ahead, tell us what it is.
Okay. The Supreme Court decided that they were going to refuse to hear an appeal in reference to the fact that two students were fighting to be able to wear I Heart Boobies bracelets in relation to Breast Cancer Awareness Month.
I see.
They were told that they were not allowed to wear them. These are 7th and 8th grade students, and two students refused to take them off, and their parents helped them sue the school district.
Right.
It was ruled originally in August 2013 that in Philadelphia that the students were right. And that was upheld. So
okay, so the students do have a right to wear. It's a breast cancer awareness.
It's a victory for boobies.
It's a your words, not mine. But there, nevertheless, there's a bracelet that says "I Heart Boobies."
Yes, and it's for breast cancer awareness.
It's a way that's kind of a tongue-in-cheek kind of way to get more attention. That would be like if it was a serious message.
Exactly,
it might
right.
I think it's fantastic. I mean, I think you should allow me to wear an "I Heart Boobies" T-shirt on the show.
Okay.
Well, we'll
take
mind,
that. We'll take that under advisement. I'm going to spare Dave having to respond to the U.S. Supreme Court's denial of the I Heart Boobies case. Moving on quickly, we have the. Let's see. Oh, that wasn't sec. Oh, that is. Now we're up to your package, aren't we? The Ben Bossy. Okay, that's what we mean in television, by the way. Package being a television term. Okay, so the Ben Bossy story. Let's get to that. What is that, Heather?
That is a campaign meant to empower young girls.
All right, let's take a look.
It's the other B word, and Facebook Chief Operating Officer Sheryl Sandberg is on a mission to stop it. Sandberg, who wrote the best-selling book Lean In, launched the campaign along with former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice and Girl Scout CEO Anna Maria Chavez. The campaign sets out to ban the word bossy. The idea was born out of Sandberg's book, Lean In, which tries to empower women in business. Ban Bossy is an attempt to make it easier for girls to become leaders.
We know that by middle school, more boys than girls want to lead, and if you ask girls why they don't want to do it, they don't want to be disliked and they don't want to be called bossy.
Sandberg said, "We call girls bossy on the playground. We call them too aggressive or other B-words in the workplace. They're bossy as little girls, and then they're aggressive, political, shrill, too ambitious as women.
If you're a leader, your friends will get mad at you and they won't want to be your friend anymore."
Twitter was overloaded today with posts using the hashtag #BanBossy. Melody tweeted, "Hashtag #BanBossy is the best campaign I have heard of as of late. Do you know how many times I was called bossy as a kid and how horrible it felt?" On the other hand, Patrick Kopech posted on Twitter, "People need to stop trying to ban every word that hurts their precious, sensitive little feelings. Hashtag #BanBossy." Celebrities such as singer Beyonce, actress Jennifer Garner, and Glee star Jane Lynch are taking part in the campaign.
"I'm not bossy. I'm the boss."
I don't know about you, Brian. My reaction is that Heather seemed a little bossy on that story the way she read it. I don't know if your thoughts are... we're kidding around, Heather, but part of it is that there's this
she had a bat
sob. Yeah, sometimes people make jokes, and other people are like, "You see, there's the misogynistic, chauvinistic, intent coming through, disguised as humor." In fact, and there is this, how much are you allowed to joke about things such in this? Well, what do you say?
I would say that this is a positive program for young females. It's a little bit different than a lot of the comments I was reading online today where people were saying, this is because Hillary Clinton is, running for president. Sorry. And it's going to create an issue where they want to divide gender lines, basically, and it's the liberals who are doing this. And there's nothing wrong with men being bossy. People were saying, just ask Bill if Hillary is bossy or not. And my whole thing is, these are little girls. So it's positive for them to feel like they can be aggressive. They can try to obtain their dreams. They can be as in control as a man is. And
word that boys are, like, what if boys, though, are being verbally obnoxious, I guess. So what are they called? Like, what was Brian called every day when he was a kid in school?
We shouldn't go into verbal? That, Bob. I grew up in New York, Pennsylvania.
No, but what, like, if boys are verbally obnoxious, isn't there something they're called?
There's
bully.
Yeah, okay. Bully. Okay. Bully would definitely be the word.
All right, and where's the banned bully campaign?
Well, no, because that's not the same thing. Because bullying is not the same thing as leading and being, you know, more of a leader. Like, bossy can, you know, be that of directing people at the same time. Bullying, a girl can bully someone too. So I don't. I'd say aggressive in some way.
I will.
Assertive.
Assertive.
I mean, I'm just being partly. And Dave, please weigh in on this. But I'm just being sort of, I guess, devil's advocate in a sense, though. But to say that when you start worrying about, like, language too much, maybe sometimes it's real intent and real. I mean, language can drive intent, I suppose, to some degree. And
sometimes you can embrace negative parts of language too. Like, if someone, you know, calls you bossy, then say, okay, fine, I'm bossy, and roll with it.
Right.
The only thing I would say is that I think that people are taking it a little bit too far. This is more of a concept thing than it is actually trying to get rid of the word bully.
Right.
Okay. I mean, bossy.
Right.
It really does come off as kind of a, the message is intended for kids, but the campaign is about adults.
Yeah.
There's not a real message in here. You don't need to ban anything.
Okay.
The concept of boys and girls are equally capable and should strive to whatever goal they want is a very good message.
Yes.
Say that.
But Dave, while I'm sympathetic to this ban bossy thing, I actually think it's probably a bad thing to call girls. I also am sympathetic to the message that there's kind of a war on masculinity in our culture to some degree, that oftentimes maleness or general boy acting out in school is often treated as if it's wrong somehow. You can look up these campaigns too, where masculinity is being treated as some sort of disease in school, and it caught, you know, you get Ritalin basically given to you so you'll calm down if you're too much like a boy.
Well, is it masculine? What is deemed masculine behavior, or is it that they're more or less seeing masculine as aggressive behavior?
I think you're getting to it. I think a lot of times boys want to run around more and be more just and wrestle and fight and run around when they're little kids and stuff. And a lot of the school establishment views that as wrong and just sit down and be quiet. You can't stay still in your desk. Here's some Ritalin. Mm. And that happens way more to boys, right? And there's so I'm just kind of saying there are both of these things. So Dave, what do you think?
Yeah, I think it's about the message. We sometimes get too hung up on labels and what they mean and get off course from what we're actually trying to accomplish.
Okay. So we have a couple of special features here at the end of today's, new features at the end of today's Reform School. It's exciting to all of us. And one of them is the disembodied voice of Chris, who is the director of our show. But we don't have a camera to actually show him. So you just have to listen to him talk. And Chris is going to have actually be covering a tweet count. It's basically a count between Dennis Van Roekel, the NEA, National Education Association Union President, and Randy Weingarten, the AFT Union President, in terms of who tweeted more yesterday in a 24-hour period. And Chris, what do you have on that? What's the result?
Well, as you can see, Bob, Randy Weingarten has a pretty significant advantage here with 65 tweets compared to Dennis Van Roekel's zero.
Okay, that was yesterday, Monday, March 10th. It was 65 to nothing.
That's right. And the other thing about Dennis Van Roekel is that you can't even see his tweets unless you're approved as a follower of his. And he's only actually posted 13 ever.
13 total tweets in his life history. Right.
Since he's been on Twitter, which who knows how long.
All right. 13 sagely 140 character tweets, right?
It's not, yes.
Not meant for everybody.
13. Oh, yeah. It's a limited number of people get to see the 13.
Some people say more when they say less.
And so, and also, there's a website of the day you found for us?
That's right. Apparently, we got a real sicko in our neighbor to the north. Up in Canada, there's a teacher who forced a student to eat. A student threw away a black banana, and the teacher apparently thought this was wasteful or offensive and pulled it out of the garbage and forced the student to consume it.
All right, so that's a little different than just eating general garbage. That's what I thought this headline meant. It's actually a particular piece of food that was thrown away by
the
student.
That's the rotten banana.
Not as bad.
But it was in the garbage. I mean, and the point is, we can't be encouraging. I mean, we have to have, students have to know that a teacher can't tell them to eat anything.
You know, you could put your lower third on the screen there just so people that know you're talking. That's, we kind of worked on that and everything.
I don't want people to think, to think that I'm you.
No, it's a two shot now. Or cut to Heather. I don't think they're going to think you're Heather. But we know, but there we are. Yeah,
there you are.
All right, that's actually
there I am.
Good.
So
there you are.
That is the debut. I know Dave is excited about it. I can see on Dave's face the excitement that he is here for the initial debut, the inauguration of the Chris Dober Goes Disembodied Voice.
Chris, was this a this teacher? Was she a food hoarder, or is that any like?
I have no idea. It's just it bothers me on the level that I'm a bit germophobic, and if a teacher had asked me to eat something out of the garbage, I would have ran away. And you know, the fact that a student can get in trouble for that, and the administration's acting like it's no big deal, kind of bothers me.
I would urge the viewers to know that we will have better websites from Chris in the future. This initial one should not be viewed as an indicator of all of our future crazy websites to close the show with. But more importantly, Dave Trabert has joined us. We want to thank Dave for being with us from the Kansas Policy Institute. We appreciate your time. Thanks so much.
Happy to be here. Thanks.
All right. And to all of you who are watching, thank you for watching. Reform School. And what am I thanking her to? I'm thanking Heather. What about Brian?
No, I'm good.
Oh, she's got the bat? All right. See, that was a bossy gesture, one might say. We'll see you next time.